Good morning. Let us quickly cover up the knowledge that you need to approach a case of slipped capital femoral epiphysis. In this slide, you see that the metaphysis, the neck of the femur, has moved superiorly in relation to the physis, in relation to the head, because the growth plate has slipped. In the frog position or lateral view, you find that it has, the physis has moved back in relation to the metaphysis in the lateral view. So this is what a slipped capital femoral epiphysis is, that the physis moves back and down in relation to the metaphysis. So one factor is the mechanical factor. You can see the weight and the ground reaction force will produce a shearing stress on the growth plate. So if the growth plate is horizontal, the weight and the ground reaction force will compress it. But if it is vertical, they will produce a shearing stress and allow the stress to occur. The other reason is the weakness of the growth plate to resist stress forces, because of a weak growth plate due to endocrinal factors. The commonest being hypogonadic, obese male with or without multiple endocrinal abnormalities. So this is what you see in histology. You see that this is the resting zone of the chondrocytes. Then they proliferate in these columns. Then they become hypertrophied. You can see the paired chondrocytes here. And finally, there is a zone of ossification, which you see here. So this separation or slip occurs at the junction of the proliferative and the hypertrophic zone. There is widening of the growth plate from 6 to 12 millimeters. The chondrocytes are large. There is an altered physial height and organization. And there's disruption of the chondrocyte differentiation and ossification. So these are the histological factors that occur in this growth plate and produce the slip. Now, what prevents the slip? One thing that prevents the slip is a perichondral ring complex, which is specially posterior, and this would prevent this posterior slip like this. And the second thing is that from the zone of ossification, there are mammary processes which are invading the cartilage of the physis, and these mammary processes must fail to allow the slip. Now what happens is that as the physis slips posteriorly, the posterior retinacular vessels become short, and therefore in chronic cases, if you reduce the physis, then these vessels will become stretched and there will be avascular necrosis. Therefore, in chronic cases, you have to remove this much portion of the neck, which is of the trapezoid shape, so it is called as trapezoid osteotomy, and then reduce the head and fix it, retain it by a trans growth plate pin, so that the blood supply to the physis is maintained. So this osteotomy is called as trapezoid osteotomy. If we want to revise the blood supply of the head, so this is the femoral artery. It has given giving the profunda femoris. The profunda femoris gives the posterior medial and the lateral circumflex femoral, which form an arterial arcade in the subtrochanteric region. And the ascending branches from the medial and lateral circumflex femoral form an arterial arcade at the base of the neck. And from these arteries arise the lateral epiphyseal vessels, which cross the growth plate and supply the head. The other supply is from the ligamentum teres, the blood vessel coming parallel to the ligamentum teres and piercing the head in the region of fovea capitis. But this vessel only has the 3% of the supply, and all the rest of the supply are from these lateral epiphyseal vessels, which are also called as retinacular vessels. So you must remember that if we reduce a chronic slip, we are likely to stretch the posterior retinacular vessels and produce avascular necrosis. And therefore, a chronic slip needs to be open reduced after doing a trapezoid osteotomy. The incidence of slipped femoral epiphysis is 2 per 100,000, varying from 1 to 7, depending on the race, the ethnicity, and the white-black ratio. The male is to female ratio is 2:1, and left is more common than the right. Now, this is the method for measuring the slip. In the AP view, you join the two ends of the physis and you draw a right bisector so that you know the axis of the physis, and then this angle, it makes a 120 degree angle from the axis of the shaft of femur on the slip side and of 145 degree angle at the non-slip side. So in this circumstance, if these are the values, you will have to do 35 degree of 25 degree of correction of adduction deformity in a subtrochanteric osteotomy. Same way, in the lateral view, you draw a right bisector of the line joining the two ends of the physis and the axis of the femur. Normally, the angle should be about 10 degrees, but on this side, it is showing to be about 80 degrees. So this method is called as the Southwick-Dixon method of measuring the degree of slip. Then in such cases, you must rule out the list of these disorders or syndromes which are associated with the slipped femoral epiphysis, like hypothyroidism, osteodystrophy of chronic renal failure, growth hormone deficiency, adipose, genital syndrome, Turner syndrome. And so these types of syndromes can be associated with slipped femoral epiphysis and they must be ruled out. So the patient presents as an acute case or a chronic case. In acute case, in an obese hypogonadic male with or without endocrinal abnormalities, there is pain, swelling, deformity and loss of function around one or both hips following mild injury. On examination, there is limitation of internal rotation because of the posterior slip of the physis and limitation of abduction because of the inferior slip of the physis. In chronic, there is an insidious onset, painless limitation of internal rotation and abduction, and you do not have that acute picture. Sometimes the acute picture can superimpose on the chronic picture, and that is called as the acute on chronic presentation. Functionally, if the slip increases with time, it is called as unstable. If it doesn't change with time, it is called as stable. The diagnostic investigation is an X-ray of the pelvis AP view with the hip in neutral position and hip in frog leg position to get the lateral view. And we have told you how to draw the Southwick angles to demonstrate the degree of the inferior and the posterior slip. So the management of the acute slip is reduce and retain with one or two pins through the center and perpendicular to the growth plate. Precaution is you must stop 8 millimeters short of the subchondral line of the physis in the AP and lateral view. In the chronic slip, you must detect the slip and the angle of the slip, and you must consider the duration of the slip. You must understand that closed reduction can stretch the posterior vessels. See, this epiphysis has slipped posteriorly, so the posterior retinocular vessels are short, so you will have to do an open reduction, and you will have to excise this portion of the neck before you reduce it, so that you don't stretch the posterior retinocular vessels and don't produce avascular necrosis. This osteotomy is called as trapezoid osteotomy of the neck of femur in chronic slip. Then, in old cases, with the growth plate already fused, you must estimate the functional deformity, and if external rotation and adduction is significant to affect gait, you must do a subtrochanteric close wedge Southwick-Dixon osteotomy, correcting the limitation of abduction and limitation of internal rotation. Thank you.